be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship this morning as we gather for a service of Holy Communion. We'll be following Divine Service Setting Number 1 in the hymnal this morning. We had the very successful chicken barbecue yesterday, and there are just 16 chicken dinners left. So if you would like to get a chicken dinner for today or take it home and put it in the refrigerator, there are 16 of them left. And you can get those after the service. In our prayers this morning, we're praying for Christine Pickard. Christine is one of our newer members, and she has had open heart surgery and is now in the hospital recovering, so we pray for her recovery. We pray for Joanne Clark and Janet Wagner, who will be having surgery, not this week, but the following week. And we also have a prayer of a celebration and thanksgiving in our family for our newborn grandson with the very unique name of Finbar. Finbar was an Irish saint. And Lori being Irish, our son is delving into Irish lore, so his son bears that name, Finbar James Bauch, born September the 29th. Let us now stand as we begin our worship by singing hymn 802, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
By what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins, as a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority. I therefore forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain.
Behold, children are our heritage from the Lord, and the fruit of the womb our reward.
Like arrows in the hand of a warrior are the children of one's youth.
Blessed is the man who fills his quiver with them. He shall not be put to shame when he speaks with his enemies in the gate.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
In peace let us praise you, O Lord.
It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. So out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens, and brought them to the man to see what he could call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all livestock, and to the birds of the heavens, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up his place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman, and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is a bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This will read from Hebrews, beginning at chapter 2. Therefore, we must pay closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by angels proved to be reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? It was declared at first by the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard. But God also bore witness by signs and wonders, and various miracles, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. Now it was not angels that God subjected to the world to come, of which we are speaking. It has been testified somewhere, "What is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you take care of him? You made him a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, putting everything in subjection under his feet. Now, in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him. But we see him for a little while, was made lower than angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of his death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting that he, by whom all things exist, and bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of our salvation perfect through suffering. For he sanctifies, and those who are sanctified have all one origin. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers, saying, I will tell you of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Congregation, please stand as we sing the Alleluia in verse. Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. And they were bringing children to him that he might touch them. And the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter." And he took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands on them. This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess our faith, speaking together the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible,
and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated as we sing hymn 862, O Blest the House.
Thank you.
Once again, with malice and envy in their hearts, the Pharisees came in order that they would test Jesus. The malice that they had toward Jesus would persist until finally it would give birth to those shouts of "Crucify him! Crucify him!" forcing Pontius Pilate under great duress to make that final verdict of death. Their envy of Jesus resented his independence of them, resented his wisdom that came from above, and they were acutely afraid of losing their place of honor in Israel. And so this trick question they put to Jesus concerns whether or not he would permit divorce. They already knew from the law that Moses made an allowance for it. If Jesus were to contradict Moses in anything, felt they would have the grounds to destroy him. Jesus, on the other hand, came not to destroy anything, but to save all people. But the last thing they wanted was to rescue from their sin, or peace from their troubled hearts, inflamed with malice and envy toward the Son of God. But what wrong could they say Jesus had ever done? Did he ever teach anything that was against the Holy Scriptures? Was he really out to get their jobs? Was he really out to get their souls? After all, Jesus opens his mouth and he speaks the truth about marriage. Even though Moses did permit a certificate of divorce, God's will was for husband and wife to be one flesh, and for that oneness to last for life. Now that sounds simple enough, but it has never been easy, never been simple to accomplish this marriage that lasts until death do the couple part. Instead, for many people, marriage lasts as long as that spark of attraction lasts. We know that boredom or lust is no ground for divorce, but often those things replace love and honor between husband and wife. And really, fewer and fewer people are actually getting married these days, claiming they don't even need a certificate of marriage to be married. And for those that do, how many of their wedding guests wonder secretly, how long is this one going to last? God's will for marriage is clear when the Son of God taught that what therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. And what Jesus says here applies to all marriages, not just for Christians entering marriage. Now, God had given us this gift of marriage already in the days of paradise, before sin came into the world. And after creating Eve, God brought her to the sleeping man to end his loneliness. That was God's idea, that was God's doing. Adam had made no suggestion, he hadn't offered any plans to end this state of isolation. He didn't complain to God, he simply received this gift of a wife. With great joy that God had graced him with a companion who was meant for him and him alone. This is why every husband and every wife should treasure one another as long as they breathe. Looking into the eyes of your spouse, you see a most precious gift from your Creator, who has uniquely gifted you now with oneness. These are the gifts that are meant for all who enter God's holy estate of marriage. But sin, as always, is the problem. Sin is the problem that steals the wedding gifts from the hearts of those who stand at God's altar. And I guess we can even ask ourselves now in the 21st century, is marriage even still a holy estate? Western civilization has tinkered with it, tweaked and pulled and redefined it as merely a social construct that is man-made rather than God-given. And if we insist on our own definition of marriage, determined by our society, based on our rational thinking and the latest Supreme Court rulings, then we have either lost or we have completely discarded God's design After all, Jesus was there when Adam was put into that deep sleep and Eve was made. The blueprint for our earthly marriage was already drawn in heaven, and it is based on another marriage. It's based on the one marriage in heaven that lasts forever between Christ and his bride, the church. And when in Ephesians, St. Paul refers to the mystery of the oneness of husband and wife, he's basing that whole thing on the mystery of Christ and his church. So which comes first, the earthly or the heavenly? Well, since Christ is eternal, with no beginning and no end, his being one with his church comes before earthly marriages. Sadly, though, the joy of being one with Christ and being forgiven and loved by him was far from the hearts of these Pharisees, who simply wanted to destroy Jesus. They, along with that wicked generation, wanted the freedom to do with marriage what they wanted and end it when it was convenient. And since Moses had made a provision for it, they would use the teaching of Jesus that marriage was lifelong in order to discredit it. Now, the Pharisees had their dispute with Jesus, but in our gospel reading this morning, it ends with a misunderstanding by the disciples of Jesus. They also must have been troubled by his teaching on divorce, probably because it just made them feel uncomfortable. Maybe they had close friends who were divorced and remarried. What would God say to them? Can one remain in the church and be remarried? Jesus clearly upholds the life law state of marriage. And he even goes as far as to say, when a divorced person remarries, they're committing adultery. And if God still upholds and recognizes that first marriage, what does that say to those who have now become one with somebody outside of it? This is indeed a hard saying. This is something that's very difficult to swallow. It confronts our reasoning that a bad marriage should end when it's necessary to preserve the health of the one that's oppressed. And we justify something that God calls sin. Should we hold the preservation of our mental health above God's word? Can we say that God's word is true except in maybe this case or that case? Well, to be sure, the Bible does allow for the possibility of divorce. They were right about Moses in instances of adultery or desertion. But because divorce always involves sin, it always requires repentance and forgiveness. Remember that St. James wrote, if one breaks the law in one point, he's guilty of breaking all of it. And ending what God has joined together is a sin, as is anything that would violate God's holy will for us. So instead of justifying and rationalizing sin and excusing divorce, flee to Christ. Come to Christ for mercy. Because your heavenly bridegroom says to you, I've taken your sin to be my own, all of it. I'm the one who was separated from my Father on the cross, and now you are mine forever. And I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. And it's in this undying love of Christ for us, that's where we find our hope and peace and forgiveness. God has joined us lowly sinners to our holy Savior in a union of endless love that always gives a refuge to lost sinners, always restores the joy of heaven to the lowest and the most despised. And so for the divorced, there is hope in Christ. As he patiently taught his disciples about the sanctity of marriage, he just as patiently forgives you and welcomes you. So Jesus' disciples heard what Jesus had taught about the adultery of remarriage. And then they go on in the last part of the gospel reading today to do something kind of strange. They immediately begin to rebuke the mothers who were bringing their little children blessed by Jesus. If God had intended children to be brought into the world through the love of husband and wife in the estate of marriage, why then would anyone keep them from Jesus, who's the door to heaven? Did they think that their master could not be bothered with these little sniffling toddlers? Was his work too important for children? Here the disciples are not filled with any malice. There's no envy like the Pharisees, but just plain ignorance of God's kingdom. Children are a gift of God when and where it pleases him to give them. And Jesus says they are the greatest examples of the kingdom of grace because they come offering nothing. They can only receive. They have no impressive resumes to qualify them for heaven, no outward good works to show. And yet, what does Jesus say? Whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. When Jesus receives a child in holy baptism, there's the clear picture of God's grace, welcoming a child into heaven. That child has nothing to offer God. God simply takes a little sinful being and joins them to Christ in a holy washing of water in his word and makes them heirs of heaven. These little ones can do nothing but receive God's grace. And that's the way it is for all of us. For all of Jesus' disciples, whether we're infants or adults. Jesus took them into his arms, and he wouldn't let anyone get in his way for his beloved children. And Jesus is still patient, and he's still loving with us. And his forgiveness doesn't entitle us to change his design for marriage, nor does it allow us to treat children as anything less than blessings. In confessing our sin, Jesus always forgives. He will never divorce his church. And what God has joined together, no one, not even the devil or any power, can separate. Jesus remains constantly devoted to his bride in that love that we can rest securely through all eternity. Amen. Congregation, please stand if you are able as we pray the prayer of the church. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, help us by your Spirit to receive your kingdom in humble repentance like little children, that we may enter it in the joy of your forgiveness in Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may pay closer attention to your word, never drifting away from it nor neglecting the great salvation it reveals to us in Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, in a reflection of your eternal love, you join man and woman together, so they are no longer two, but one. Bless the engaged and the newly married and those long time married with even more of your love, that they may live together in it with joy their whole lives long. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, be with Kevin and Allison and their newborn baby Finbar James, and all parents who have brought their children to Christ in the waters of holy baptism, that he might bring them to be faithfully in the divine service with us, that he may continue to take them in his arms and bless them through his word. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, help us when we fail to see ourselves and everything in relation to Jesus. Give us eyes of faith to see him crowned with glory and honor, and to believe that nothing is outside his control. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, comfort all those who suffer in body or in mind. Be with Lynn Ambrose and Bill Ayler, Sharon Ayler, Jim Berkles, Kevin Bruning, Joanne Clark, Connie Davis, Nancy Forbes, Denise Jambroni, Dorothy Haas, Gary Hill, Rob Matisak, Mike Baker, Carolyn Myers, Emma, Christine Pickard, Darwin Bowler, Dick Redunds, Eliana Randall,
Nancy Smith, Joanne Wagner, and Janet Wagner. You made the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering, that in all their trials they might put their trust in you. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, deepen us in the truth that Jesus has made us bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh, that we may believe that he will hold fast to us forever. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
You may want to turn to your neighbor and simply offer the peace of the Lord. Peace of the Lord be with you all. Please remain standing as we sing hymn 781, We Give Thee But Thine Own, verses 1 through 4.
Thank you.
when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will strengthen and preserve you in true faith to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Savior Jesus Christ will strengthen and preserve you in true faith to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Savior Jesus Christ will strengthen and preserve you in true faith and life everlasting. Depart in peace. Congregation, please stand as we sing, "Thank the Lord." strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
God of grace and God of glory.